Thanks, Peter. Thanks for a wonderful run-through. So I'm going to present certain case presentations, and we will have inputs from you as well as our expert panelists on how you would address those situations. So if you all know that while doing total knee replacement, it is likely that a surgeon might encounter dilemma, obstacles, potential crisis, certain things expected and certain things unexpected on the table. Because it is very different for us in India, because normally for majority of our centers, we are not as well equipped as a backup. So we need to anticipate the problems. We need to have the way in and way out for those problems. So what are the bailout options for these problems? So now the problems can occur during exposure, trialing, or implantation. What I want to run through now is certain case presentations. These are my disclosures. I do research concerning speaking first person after and merit. The first caveat I would like to tremor is see the complication before it sees you. Now, let me start up with Dr. Hulse, Dr. Nayan. So if you are going in a situation and you realize that you have done a femoral cortical perforation, either just in the entry or say mid area at the isthmus, what would you do at that stage? So you have this vision.
So I can see there's an anterior perforation of the distal femur to your implantatory guide. And you have a small perforation which is like about 10% of the cortical diameter of the distal femur. I would suggest that, you know, this is not a major issue. You can fill that area with a graft, and most likely you can use a normal component. In case this is a very osteoporotic bone, and also if your anterior cut has gone through that hole again, making that hole bigger, you may end up putting a small stem for this femoral component.
I think well done for summarize. For majority of these perforations in the anterior cortex, you can go with it. They happen in the beginning or they happen at the mid-shaft level. If it is in the initial area under the cut, these are the kind of perforations, you can plug them with a bone graft and proceed on with a normal implant. Well summarized, Nayan.
Yeah.
So now this goes to my dear friend, Nilin. You are a CR user like me, right? So Nilin, yes. You are there. So you are trialing your component, you are doing perfectly well, it was a bit tight inflection, you went across and you have an avulsion of your PCL from the tibial base. Now what is the carry home message? Would you convert to a PAS, or how would you handle this kind of a situation?
Manoj, this happens fairly frequently, I would say. And I would not even consider a complication, because most of the knee implants that you have, they have curved inserts as well. So a deep dish or something would be available, and then you can put that in and it will be pretty okay. The other thing that I feel is that if on trialing it has happened, that means that the knee was a little tight in flexion, and this has actually balanced your knee quite well.
Yeah.
So but I would not worry too much unless there is a definite, you see a posterior sag inflection. If you see a posterior sag inflection and a deep dish is not there, I would convert to a PS.
Good. Let me summarize. I think wonderfully said, Nilin. Majority of these things are around if you have balanced your knee well in flexion as well as extension, move on with the normal insert. If at all you still want to be safe, move a deep dish on an ultra concrete insert. Very, very rarely, as you say, you have a sag or so, you will have to convert this to a PS. Majority of these knees do not require any special intervention. Now, Dr. Narendra Reddy, you are doing your tibial resection or the femoral resection, accidentally you cut across your popliteus tendon, either at the base on the lateral femoral condyle or mid substance. What would you do at that stage? What is the carry home message?
Yeah, this is the most common thing to happen when you do a surgery. You tend to cut the popliteus. I don't think there is much to need it to do with this unless you feel it is opening on the lateral side. Otherwise, I think a cut on the popliteus, if you can put a stitch and repair it, leave it. Otherwise, if you are not able to do that, I think it doesn't make any big difference. Nothing much is needed to do once you find that popliteus is cut. That's my personal
The karyocrux message is that, as Narendra also says, that unlike a native knee where cutting popliteus would give you a lot of femoral instability, majority of these cases, it's best if you can suture them. Even if not, it is not going to give you much of a femoral instability, and it is very tough to identify that laxity in varus flexion internal rotation, and you can just walk away over it. So, again, Narendra, going back to you, you have this kind of stuff, and going on, you have some sort of avulsion at the femoral attachment of MCL. How do you sort of bail out? This is a very common complication.
The most common complication what I see is this avulsion of medial collateral ligament. Mostly when I'm operating with this rheumatoid knees, or if you don't properly balance a varus knee, when you're doing a trial, when you extend and flexion it, if you don't balance them properly, most of the times you find this small avulsion from the medial side. Unless sometimes it's a good to have that.
How would you address this? Is my question.
Hello.
How would you address this complication?
If my trial is looking good and with the stable knee, I just leave it. But sometimes, rarely, if it is a medial opening, is there? I just put a screw and leave at this point of time. And because most of the times I do a PS. And rarely I've gone for a constrained poly for this small avulsion on the MCL.
Yeah, small amount of avulsions like this, either they can be left as such, or you can put one or two caster screws with washer and replace them. We all see a lot of those because we have a lot of osteoporotic, osteopenic bones. And normally they don't require a very special intervention, just screws holds them well. And PS gives you a sort of a bailout over doing a CR in these cases. But yes, for an expert, majority cases can even be tackled with a CR knee. Notching that we normally see across, normally you can leave it. I'll just summarize that. Any notching that is less than 3 mm or not going through the dark cortex, just don't worry about it. But if there is a significant notching more than 3 millimeters or full thickness of iliac cortex, you have to understand that you are going to leave a high stress area, and there's going to be potential reduction of torsional strength by 30 to 40% and flexural strength by 18%. Now, this goes on to my dear friend Avtar. Avtar, you have been working a big way on through the emerging technologies over the past in navigation as well as robotics. This is not an uncommon situation. We used to have those thick threaded pins into the femur and the tibia. You're seeing and putting a pin. And when you sort of extend the knee, you have a sort of a fracture in that area. You must have gone through these complications. How did you address those?
See, Manoj, nice talking to you. Normally, when I started with navigation, I used to put my pins in the femur, much above the incision line, and same way, much below the incision line on the tibial side. And I always try to put unicortical pins, so that normally avoids your fractures. But I had three fractures in my practice during last 15 years when I started with navigation and now with robotics. All fractures were with navigation. One was in the tibial diaphysis, which I nailed from above below, I mean anterograde nailing. Then I had a fracture in the tibial shaft, again much below the prosthesis, which I plated. And then one fracture where I had to revise the tibial component with a stem. This is how I sorted out all my fractures.
Yeah, majority of these fractures, you rightly said, would require some sort of an intervention or a fixation, which normally is reduction in using these kind of distal femoral locking plates. But yes, you have other options to fix up when it is a femur. Same way for the tibia. For a couple of those very geriatric fractures, if they get through and the patient is not very highly ambulatory, you can even try conservative. This is one of the cases we tried conservative with a immobilization for 2 to 3 months and developed a good deal of callus. But that's not the normal protocols. Normally, for majority of them, would require this kind of a distal femoral locking plate and fixation. Now, depends that if you are going to have a double column fracture, then you require double plates.
I agree with Manoj. I had one patient with this kind of fracture, which you just showed. I advised her surgery, but she was adamant that I need a plaster, and she was perfectly fine after 3 months.
So whenever using plates, use a longer working length, use bicortical purchase, try to have screws rather than just the cables. Bicortical purchase is best. Even if not, then unicortical purchase along with long shaft screws. Try atraumatic techniques with indirect reduction. This is a message very, very common. We have seen a lot of our friends doing this kind of a reverse impaction, taking out the femoral trial. In osteoporotic bones, this is one of the catastrophe that can put you to a lot of trouble. Use this kind of extractors as a first parameter. Similarly, for the tibial fractures, we all have seen that when you have a compacted medial side, many times when you're trying to broach in or you're trying to impact in, you have these kind of fractures. Unwanted, uncalled for, and the troublesome time is if you do not have backups available on table, be it the tibial extenders or these kind of plates. Same time, when you have these kind of intra-op tibial fractures developing in, how do you address those, Nalin?
Best way is to avoid it.
True.
So be very, very careful. Whenever you are putting the tibial component, there is no need to hammer it, you know, vigorously. Just place it gently, place your femoral component, put in the trial insert and get the tibia to settle. But obviously, if you have some fracture like this, you will have to fix it.
Yeah.
And this uni that you have shown, I think it would be better to revise it on table to a total. And I think this total knee with a stem that you have shown, probably I will put an extra plate on the medial side here to stabilize it.
I think wonderfully summarized. Majority of them would require screws or an extender along with that. And a couple of them would require a supportive plate. So to summarize, vertical metaphyseal fractures due to impaction. If they are stable and non-displaced, you fix them with 1 to 2 screws. If they are unstable and displaced, screws plus stem, as Nalin rightly told you. I had, Nalin, this kind of a fracture. Victor, I don't know whether you've seen those. We have our very small ladies, and when we use size 1 or 2, like example, Gen 2 tibia, they have a long keel, which in the last impaction was hitting onto the posterior cortex and had this fracture on the table, which I had no choice than to wire through because no stem would bypass this area. Luckily, she healed. And this was one of the prototype when I was designing the anterior knee. I designed a much smaller keel. But this is one of the complications. I'm very sure a couple of our friends see with a certain kind of implant for short statured females. Now, this for you, Dr. Hulse. 69-year-old female with obesity, BMI around 30-35. Diabetes mellitus on antidepressants, OA grade 4, both knees. We did PKR left knee. We were pretty fast. Tourniquet time was 25 minutes. But 4 hours after surgery, we had a situation where our distal pulses were becoming feeble. Capillary refill for more than 2 seconds. Calf tenderness, decreased sensation, ankle toe movements decreased. What would come to your spine?
I mean, this is typical of a vascular injury. That's why it's very critical that, you know, we identify them immediately just after the surgery. Either in the recovery, you know, have a protocol to check the distal pulse, or have a pulse oximeter or a Doppler done on them as a protocol. So we need a further assessment of this patient, ideally with the help of a vascular surgeon, who will probably assess this patient with an arterial Doppler or a color Doppler. And then, you know, from that point of view, we will take further, and most likely it's a vascular injury needing some immediate attention.
So this was a popliteal artery thrombosis. As you rightly said, went in for immediate Doppler, which showed left popliteal artery did not show any color flow in the mid-distal part, was thrombosed. With the vascular, we went in for CT angio, which showed non-opacification and 2 centimeters of thrombus. Immediately was taken in, we found 2 centimeter thrombus. They removed it through, the skin started becoming warm, and the patient was doing well. But over the next 3 to 4 days, despite using heparin and other anticoagulants and other medical management, she still started deteriorating, and we had a rethrombosis of left popliteal artery. Did fasciotomies, tried to save it, but ultimately, unfortunately, as Dr. Victor also said, we had no other choice than to unfortunately give her above knee amputation. So take them very, very carefully. Despite doing all those things, even then, despite, you will be, can be unlucky.
Usually they have an intimate injury, and the thrombectomy alone may not be of help. Yes. And a lot of these vascular surgeons do anastomose directly.
Dr. Manoj, Anu, can I say something? Nowadays we are shortening the length of stay of the patients. We're trying to send it home. Here we are sending home a day of surgery. So we have to be extra careful with these patients, because just checking the pulses can bring red flags to you, and you can prevent. If you send one of these patients home and comes 3 days after, you just have to amputate from scratch. So.
True. So this was again the next case of a fused knee. We tried to reconstruct, was totally fused, adherent, patellectomized, stiff. We could achieve in bending, but a couple of hours after surgery, she was still bleeding. This guy was bleeding, and when we went for NGO, we found that there was some sort of a perforation in the popliteal artery. This is one thing you will be very, very careful for these kind of situations where you have a lot of stiff and adherent knees. You need to protect and be careful. Like for a left knee, I would suggest to the younger surgeons, try to avoid 1 centimeter area lateral to the midline where you have the neurovascular areas. And if you have a throbbing pulsations, that means you are perforated into the popliteal artery by your Homans or your saw, something of that sort. We had to turn the patient upside down and repair the popliteal artery by the vascular team. So be very, very cautious. Remember that these things can come on. Don't try to fiddle across from the front of the knee, because you'll not be able to reach into the tear. Turn the patient upside down and formulate and repair this artery. To summary of this vascular injury, it's a rare but limb-threatening complications of TKR, an incidence of 0.03 to 0.5%. Hemorrhage you can discover intraoperatively after tourniquet deflation. If you have a direct penetrating trauma, you can cause hemorrhage, pseudemsum, or AV fistula. But indirect blunt trauma with a hot cement or a tourniquet or a manipulation can cause edematous plaque and thromboembolic complications. Now, going on to extended tendon injuries, we had this kind of a failed arthrodesed left knee coming to us for revision. This was her picture. We knew the conditions. She's going to have a tough exposure, poor bone quality, but luckily infection was not there. Expectations, we tried to tone it down. Now, addressing this, I am just going to summarize. You normally would use extensile exposures like a TTO. I was not very hopeful the TTO will work for this kind of a parameter. We tried to move in as such. We had some sort of avulsion of the base of patellar tendon. Still, patella baja does persist on. We did a transosseous repair. So the ways to move across is considering extensile exposures right in the beginning, not just the snip that we did for this case, but maybe a tibial tubercle osteotomy would have been a better learning point. So these damages and extensive tendon can happen during the denervation of patella, mid tendon using a saw blade cut that you can accidentally put in, or like in this case, during exposures and avulsion of tibial tetral attachment. But majority of these can be repaired with transosseous sutures. So all of us see these kind of patellofemoral instabilities, and you need to look in whether you have put internal rotation of the tibial or the femoral component or the patellar component. If all of three are fine, you have to do a lateral retinaculosis release to check on that there is no thumb technique and the patella seats very well into the trochlear sulcus. Now going on this to now put it across to Nilin, you have this kind of a bilateral, not very uncommon for Indian systems. You have an adherent MCL and very varus knee with a bone collapse. Also, you try to circumvent around the medial side, do all sorts of parameters. Your deep MCL is already released in the beginning. Semiremnus is released on. You went on and you did a chelectomy and osteophytectomy. Everything is done. You still have a trapezoidal part. You went across an osteotome releasing visceral MCL. Suddenly, you have a click and your knee is a bit unstable in flexion. What is your working diagnosis?
Manoj, last 2 minutes, please.
Okay.
Yeah.
The scenario that you are describing is a disruption of the MCL.
Yeah.
So here what I would see is that whether it is completely unstable or partly unstable, and whether I have released the PCL or I have not released the PCL. If I have not yet released the PCL, even if the MCL partly disrupted, I think a normal insert would work reasonably well. But if the PCL is also disrupted, then I would probably try to go in for some kind of higher constraint.
Good. So normally, a message for audience is, normally a PS does not work if you have an instability still persisting. There you have to have a varus valgus constraint or a PS plus kind of an intervention. You have these kind of pictures where you have stretchings of the MCL and you need to check on the status. Be very careful when you use these kind of small sort of rectangular blocks in trapezoidal large size bones where your blade is free and can damage the popliteus or your collaterals. We had a case in which there was accidental cutting of MCL and a free semi-T graft was used across, another where semi-T augmentation was also done. So in all those cases, you can repair your MCLs or you can augment them with semi-T across in these cases. Similarly, for acute valgus flexion deformities, your peroneal nerve can also have a compression. Guru, I'll just take 2 minutes and I'll sort of close the working points. Sure. This is the sizing of the implants complication. You use the novel implants and you have this kind of an overhang, which in a couple of cases beyond a certain millimeters can be, you can build out with narrow trochlear implants. Similarly, on the tibia, if you have an impingement, despite using the very small sizes, pressing on the posterolateral corner, you can use asymmetric tibias and walk off it. So in all these things, you can prevent those failures. You can use extensile osteotomies. But if you still have failures of these mechanisms, Victor has nicely summarized the propylene mesh that you can use on. You can use these kind of containment with SS wires also for a secondary reinforcement. Now, the last complication that I have seen across the last few months is only pertinent to the Indian system. My Indian friends, Victor, would have never ever seen it. And this I called as a COVID-19 Indian complication, where you enter the OTA and you get to know you don't have this size of tibia, this size of fibula, this size of patella and insert. Because of the COVID, supplies have been short. Our India system is not very profitable for the industry. And I'm very sure, coming from the heart, majority of us are facing these kind of implant shortages, which in itself are coupling to complications. With this, I open the desk across. Any questions from the fellow colleagues or panelists, we are more than happy to answer.